relevant mobile track. And we are having a lot of talks today on Kotlin, .NET, and we will be having a workshop on Kotlin as well. So you guys have seen my talk yesterday maybe, and now I'm the moderator and he's going to be moderating today itself. So I'd like to welcome you all to this track and hope you learn a lot.
Huge round of applause to you guys for coming in so early.
Thank you.
Over to Harshit. Hello. So I'm the moderator for this track and I'm the speaker, coincidentally. So the first talk, it's going to be on Kotlin. So just a quick show of hands, how many of you guys are Java developers or are familiar with Java? How many of you guys hate Java? None? Okay, so presumably after today's session, we'll start to hate Java. And that's in a good way. Like, that's me speaking in a good manner because I'll introduce to something which is more interesting than Java. Okay, it's more fun than Java. It's better than Java, so it's a better Java. So I'm Harshit, I'm an Android developer, and I'm also an Android instructor. I'm from New Delhi, India, and I work at a startup that's Coding Blocks. We train people to build better Android, web, and backend stacks. Right. So, yeah, just said that. Okay, I'm an Android developer that loves to make better and beautiful apps. Okay, yeah. So, having said that, Android dev stack is the biggest shit stack that's available right now because a lot of things messed up, the APIs are broken. Okay, there's no set pattern that you can follow because, like, let's face it, any Android devs here? Oh, awesome, Android. So, I'm pretty sure you guys are familiar with Dart, right? Dart and Flutter. Yeah, so Google themselves, they are competing with their own framework. So, like, first of all, they have Android native, then they have Flutter. Like, so I'm not sure what's going on, there are a lot of other frameworks in the market. So there's nothing like, there's no set standard for developers to create apps. And yeah, that's the issue. So these words were said by Steve Yeager. Okay, he's an ex-Googler, works at Grab right now. Okay, and an awesome guy, a great developer. Right? So yeah, so this is the current status of the whole Android framework. Okay, and this a lot of these things apply to Java as well. If you are writing server in Java or if you're writing desktop apps in Java. So like I'll just go through them one by one. So first of all, the whole ecosystem is very fragmented. So you have OEMs like Samsung, LG, Sony, Xiaomi, Huawei, tons more. Like, they have their own implementation of Android. So like, if you write an app that works on 10 devices, but it definitely won't work on the 11th device. Okay, because the manufacturer decided, okay, oh, we don't want this API in, and they throw it out. So like, your entire app breaks and you get a lot of one-star reviews saying, okay, this app does not work on my phone. You're like sitting there scratching your head, like thinking why it's not working. But the reason is because it's not your fault. It's fault of the manufacturer who made that OS, okay, for their devices. So yeah, so like, the entire OS system is very much fragmented and it's overly complicated, right? Next up is, we have a lot of boilerplate garbage. So like, if this thing looks familiar to you, like writing anonymous in a classes, right? Like, so this code, like this is the code in Android that you have to write just to handle a single button click. So if I have a screen, I want to handle a button click, write all these things. It does not make any sense. Okay. Next up is null pointers. So I'm pretty sure everyone is familiar with null pointers. Okay. So like, the language, it's not very forgiving. Java in terms of exceptions. So if you make any slightest error, like, it'll throw this like a well-known, like the famous null pointer exception, and your app will crash. So that's it. And yeah, so also there are too many languages and too less time. So if today someone wants to start his career as an Android developer, so he can code in all these languages, right? So Java, C++, Scala, Groovy, Kotlin, Dart, C#, JavaScript, and Basic. Yeah, that's true. That's not like something I just put in. So you can write Android apps in Basic, okay? Just let that sink in, okay? And the thing is, like, there's a lot of confusion because like, these are just the languages. I haven't included the frameworks, the Cordova, React Native, right? There's Xamarin, there's Flutter that just came out. So like, it's very confusing for someone who wants to start his career as an Android developer today, okay? So what should we do? And what should I do as an Android developer who just wanted to start out, okay? So when I started out with Android 2 years ago,
like I didn't face this issue. Back then, like I was living in happy Java land. Okay, so there was just Java. Xamarin was there, but like it was not that famous. It was not yet acquired by Microsoft. So like it was not that famous. React Native was nothing, nowhere to be seen. Okay, so like, it was Android framework was highly dominated by Java. Like, yeah. So like that's where Kotlin enters. So any one of you guys heard about Kotlin or used Kotlin? Nice. So yeah, so what is Kotlin? So Kotlin is a language, obviously. So again, one more quote. So Kotlin is better than whatever dumb language you are using. I don't mean that to be an offense because I'm not the one who said these things, right? Also, Kotlin is sort of like it's to Java what C++ was to C, and maybe even better. So I met a few guys yesterday, they said that, okay, they hate C++ because it's overly complicated. So I'm not talking about them, but in general, like all of us know that, okay, C++ was an enhancement to C. Like it introduced many things that were not present in C. So like, that's what Kotlin aims at like doing to Java. So it like aims at fixing Java's issues and tries to bring a lot more things on the table. So like, again, these lines were taken from a blog wrote by Stevie. Okay. Awesome guy. So why Kotlin? It's concise, it's organized, it's testable, it's logical, okay. The language makes sense, it's innovative, and like not enough time to figure out, sorry. Like I just wrote these things yesterday night. Okay, maybe I could have used nice, yeah, okay. Maybe I could have used nice, but I just wrote these things like yesterday night. I just added the slide in at like 1 a.m. yesterday. So like, I'm not sorry for this. Okay. So yeah, moving ahead. Benefits of Kotlin. So it works like Java, and it's safer than Java. Right? We'll come to that, why that's the case. It's interoperable with Java. So you can have 10 files written in Java. If you add an 11th file written in Kotlin, that won't break your build. Your app will still work. Your server will still work. Okay. It's practical. Why that's the case, we'll come to it. It's concise and readable. Okay, like people argue that, okay, like this 15 line of code in Java, I can write it in a single line using Groovy. But that's not readable. If code is not human readable, it's not maintainable. People cannot contribute to it. And being from an open source organization, we want people who can contribute to our projects. So we want to ensure that, okay, our code is understandable by others, right? Also, it's evolving quickly. It has an awesome IDE support. And lastly, it's fun. Yeah. Like I love programming in Kotlin. Like the Kotlin gives me like the same feeling when I started out with coding. Like when I first wrote my first Hello World program, like I was amazed, oh wow, what's happening? So Kotlin gives me the same feeling. Like I get to learn something new every day. So it's fun, it makes programming fun once again. So there are no more null pointer exceptions. I mean, if you want, you can have null pointer exceptions, but the language itself tries to reduce the null pointers to as little as it can, because like you'll see this in the later parts of the slides. So when we were using Kotlin in our app, the crash reports went down by 43%. Right. Next up is no need for unnecessary if else blocks. I'll come to that. And smart casts are there. So like they exclude the need for nested null checks. I'll come to all these things in a bit. I'm just giving the overview. We'll come to the coding part later on. Okay. Like it works like Java and it's safer than Java. You can write code without it having to bite you in the ass. Next up is it's interoperable with Java. Many languages are interoperable with Java, but they are not perfectly. They are not done perfectly. Okay, there are some kinks in there, which break your build. But this is one of the rarest flawless interop. Right? You can change a Java file to Kotlin without messing up with the remaining code base. Okay, and it has zero effect on the runtime performance. The only performance drop you'll see, it's in compile time, and that's like very minor, maybe in milliseconds that you won't even notice. Okay. Because under the hood, the Kotlin code is converted to Java, but like it's the development time that's reduced. All right. So yeah. So it's practical, right? So it allows for things that make sense. So in Java, you cannot have multiple top level classes. So if I have a Java file, I can only have one root class. That's it. If I want to have more classes, I'll have to make them inner classes, right? But that's not the case with Java, okay? You can have global variables. In Java, like there's no concept of global variable. If you want something to be accessible from anywhere, you have to like create a final static class. Instead, you have to create a static variables, right? I hope that makes sense, right? Java guys, I hope that makes sense. So yeah, like in Kotlin, you can have global variables. You can have variables that are like, that you can call directly from any class, from anywhere, from any function. Next up, there's extension functions. We'll come to them later on. There's type inference. You don't have to specify the type, okay? For example, you don't need to specify, okay, this is an integer. It'll infer the value. It'll infer the type from the value that's assigned to it. So if you like, if you write var a equal to 5, it'll automatically infer, okay, so the variable a is of the type integer. Alright. Lastly, there's string templating. Okay, the string templating is not sound that awesome at first, but once you get to know it, once you start using it, it's pretty awesome. Okay. Now, so it's concise and readable. Okay. So it does not sacrifice safety for readability, and it's when you are writing Kotlin code, like especially in Android land, you'll end up with 30-40% less Java code, right? So if you are creating adapters in Kotlin, like the recycler view adapters, generally in Java it takes me around 70 lines of code, but with Kotlin it's only 20 lines, right? So that's one of the best parts of Kotlin. So it's also continuously evolving. So they have a 1 month release cycle for every new build, okay? Maybe even less. And yeah, so they are not ashamed in using features available in other languages. So they recently introduced coroutines, which use the async await from C#. And they're open to it, they're open about it. They don't have a very high ego that, okay, we won't use this part of the language because we are a different language. So they don't do that. The developers over there, they don't do that. Okay, by the way, just a heads up, Kotlin is written by the people, the awesome guys over at JetBrains. So JetBrains are the folks that write IDEs, they write awesome IDEs. So no matter which language you are developing in, you probably be using JetBrains IDE. So they have IDEs for Java, for Kotlin, for C, for C#, I think so, yeah, for Swift, and for JS. Also, yeah, the IDE, coming to that, so yeah. So I don't even have to memorize the code anymore. The IDE does that for me. I was teaching kids how you can write anonymous classes in Java. I was using Atom. I was not using the IDE. I just stood there thinking, okay, what should come next? Because I was spoiled by the IDE, right? Because IDE does everything for me. The moment I write A, it completes everything for me. I don't have to memorize code anymore. And that cuts down the developer time a lot. I'll trust me, if you have to write a Java line, okay, an activity class in a text editor, that'll probably take you 15-20 minutes. But with the IDE, that just takes 2 minutes. That's it. So yeah, so it's free and open source. That's the best part about it. And also it has built-in code completion and debugger. So that's an icing on the top. And yeah, it is fun. So Kotlin's fun, as I said. Yeah. So it's awesome. So that's me. Okay, so let's get to the code because no one likes talk. I hope you guys are liking this talk. Generally, we don't like talk, we like to see code. We like to see things in action. So first of all, let's get to classes in Kotlin. So I hope you guys are familiar with classes, right? Anyone of you guys who don't know what classes are? Not your traditional classes, but Java classes, or maybe C++ classes. Everyone is good? Awesome. So this is a typical Java class, okay? And this is a Kotlin class. So in Java class, you have to create getters, setter, constructors, all these things. But in Kotlin, the language does all these things for you. So you can define a class in just a single line. So this was I minified all these things, I minimized all these things. But this code was around 75 lines long. But in Kotlin, it's just a single line long. Just one line and you are done. Okay, so that's one thing. Okay. So this was the part that that was the wow moment for me when I was looking out for Kotlin. So I just said, okay, what the hell? What's happening? Where are the getter setters? Where's the constructor? Nothing. Just need to define the class and you are all done. You're good to go. Okay, also one more thing. You can have multiple root classes. So you can see there's a package name over here. Oh, by the way, no semicolons. You can skip the semicolons. You don't need the semicolons. So you have three classes in a single Kotlin file. You cannot do this with Java. You want to have multiple classes, you have to create the teacher class inside the student class. You need to have the inner classes. But in Kotlin, you can have multiple root classes. Okay? This will totally work. Okay. You won't have any issues with this. So whenever we are writing POJOs, Java objects, you can shoe also all your POJOs in a single file. Teacher, student, all those things. You can write them in a single file. Okay, that'll reduce the number of files you have. Okay. it'll make your code less cluttered. Okay, so button handling in Kotlin. This will be very familiar to the Android guys. So in Java, you have to like do something like this. You have to create an anonymous inner class, and then you have to handle the click inside this anonymous inner class. But with Kotlin, you have lambdas out of the box. So like, just write this, and you're good to go. You don't have to write even this part. So this is like just a hint that's given by the IDE. So like, skip this part. Just this, like button.setOnClickListener. You're good to go. Whereas in Java, you have to write, you have to implement an anonymous inner class inside, and then you are like able to handle clicks inside the onClick method. Okay, so that's the difference. This will be very familiar to the Android guys. So like Java 8 can do this. Like this thing is available in Java 8. Okay, but then you have to sacrifice the number of devices that you are supporting, because not every device runs on Java 8. Right? That not every device has built-in Java 8 support. Not every Android device. Right. So if you are trying to do something like this in Java, you have to like sacrifice the number of devices you are going to support. All right. So null checks in Kotlin. So in Java, you have to write this. Okay. So if button, though this is not equal to sign. Like okay. So like this is a font that I use. It automatically does this in IntelliJ IDE. But this is not equal to sign. So in Java, you have to do something like this. So if button is not equal to null, then set text to the button. If I want to do this thing in Kotlin, I can do something like this. Button question mark dot text equal to change the text. So what this will do is, if button is null, it will skip this line. Otherwise, it will set the text to change the text. Okay, it's intuitive, right? Because like, if the button is null, I don't want to touch anything, right? Because if the button is null and I try to modify anything onto it, I'll get a null counter exception. True, right? So if the button is null, skip this line. Otherwise, set the text to this thing. Okay. So no need for multiple nested if else. You can simply use the question mark dot operator. Okay, and good to go. Next is string templating. This is what I was talking about. So in Java, let's say we have two variables, two integers, num and count. I want to write a string that says, okay, button.setText, the count of number num is count. In Java, we do it like this. Okay, we append the integers to a string, and internally it uses string builders, okay, to save the memory and all. But in Kotlin, you can do something like this. So this is available in many of the languages out of the box, but it's not present in Java. So using the dollar sign,
Does it only work for values? Because you are using values here instead of variables?
No, it works for variables as well. You can change it to where and it'll work. Also, you can write if statements. You can like write logical statement inside. You can write do a curly brace and write if something, then the value of num should be this, else the value of the num should be this. So you can write logical expressions also. If you want, like you can also like you can after dollar sign, you can use a curly brace and write logical statement inside. That will work. Okay. So this was very awesome as well, because like it makes your code more beautiful. It makes it understandable, right? Because rather than having multiple plus signs, you can like simply use dollar and like do all the things that you want. Global function and variables. So venturing where no Java developer has gone before. So outside the classes. So this is my class. Okay. And now what I'm doing is, outside my class, I have a variable and a function. In Java, this will throw you a compilation error, but in Kotlin, it works. So like this API key variable and this global function, I can access these two things from anywhere. No matter what package I'm in, no matter what class I'm in, I can access these things from anywhere that I want. Okay. One reason I told you that Kotlin was fun, because we define functions with the word fun. Okay. Yeah.
How do I access these global variables from a Java file?
Yeah, you can simply call API key and it'll work. Simply just go ahead, like go into any Java file, just write in A, capital A, and you'll like see this auto suggestion. This will work. Okay. So this is like one more thing. So internally what it does is, internally it'll like place this, like when you compile the code, it'll create a final class. It'll place these variables inside the final class, and then internally it'll access them via that final class. But like, development time is reduced, right? I don't have to create a final class anymore. I don't have to create static variables or static functions anymore. Correct? So yeah, this is there. This is not present in Java. Yeah. Also, async tasks. How many of you guys know about async tasks? Oh. So async task is something that we use we don't generally use async tasks, but okay, like if you're a newcomer in Android world, you will be using async tasks to perform any asynchronous code. Like for example, what is an asynchronous code? Asynchronous code is a code that I like want to run in the background. For example, I am writing something to a file, right? So I don't want that thing to run on the main thread, because if because file writing will take, let's say, 5 to 6 seconds. And if I do that on the main thread, then my app will hang, because like user cannot do anything else on the screen, because in that screen, there's a file write happening. So everything else is blocked. So that's why we use asynchronous tasks. Asynchronous tasks are the tasks that run asynchronously in the background. Okay. So in Android, a very common pattern to do asynchronous work is using async tasks. Okay. As the name suggests, they are async tasks, asynchronous tasks. So if you write async task and run it, that runs on the background. Okay. And your main thread or your UI thread or your foreground thread is free to perform any other things that you want. So in Android, in Java, you have to create an async task like this. This is very simpler version of this. Like if you like try to do more things here, it will result in like around 100 to 150 lines of code. But in Kotlin, just this. This is like not done, like this is not present in the language out of the box, but there's a library called Anko. That's why I mentioned over here. Done using Anko. So Anko is another library, okay, that's created by JetBrains, the guys who built the Kotlin language. And like it's a library specifically aimed if you are doing Android development. So Kotlin can be used to do a lot of things. You can write web apps in Kotlin, you can write backend servers in Kotlin, you can write Android apps in Kotlin. So if you're writing Android app in Kotlin, then this library, Anko, this helps a lot. Okay. So like if you're an Android developer and you want to use Kotlin, like feel free to include this library in. It'll help you a lot. So using Anko, you can do this in just 2 lines. Okay. And there are a lot of memory issues. So like this async task has a lot of memory leak issues. Okay. Like. I won't go into the very depth of it because like it might not make sense to a lot of guys over here. But like the Android guys who use async task, I believe they know. Right? If you rotate the screen and you still have the access to the activity context here, it leaks, right? You get a lot of like memory leak warnings and your app like keeps on like eating up memory and your phone becomes slow and like all those things. But that won't happen in here, right? If you have like if you rotate your screen and the context that you have is null, it'll simply ignore it. It won't run anything. Yeah, also singletons. You guys know what singletons are? Okay, so singleton is something, okay, so let's say I want access to a class is an object. But I want, like, what I want is, at a time, only one instance of that class should be available. Let's say, how many Android devs here? Android users? Guys, come on, Android users. Okay, good. So you guys have a you guys can see notifications, right? Notifications, like you pull down, you see notifications, right? So you display notifications using a notification manager. Okay. I'm like giving you a brief overview or on how singletons are used in Android. Okay, so you display notifications using the notification manager. So at a time, so like there's only one instance of notification manager that's available after phone boots. And all the apps use that same instance to display the notifications. Okay, so that's implemented using a singleton pattern, right? So that like only a single instance of your notification manager object will be accessible. So no app can create a new instance of the notification object. Okay, I cannot create a new object of the notification manager class. I cannot do that, because if I try to do that, the OS will return me the existing instance. That's what it will do. So in Java, if I want, so that's called a singleton. That object is called a singleton object. Right, because it's a singleton. Okay, I'm not sure what ton means, but single means that. So, yeah. So this is how you implement singleton. If you look at the logic, it's very simple. So like when I try to get an instance of that singleton object, if it checks if the instance is null, then it creates an instance and then returns it. Otherwise, it simply returns the instance. Okay. If this does not make sense, no issues. Totally fine. But in Kotlin, you just have to write the keyword object. That is it. If you write object singleton, then anytime you create a new instance of this, you'll be returned an existing instance if it's present. So you don't need to have all these checks, all these static variables. You don't need to do that. This will automatically handle it for you, the object thing. So like that's one more thing. That's very good in Kotlin. That's unique in Kotlin. Okay. And there are much more things, right? There are extension functions. So like if you want to create a new method inside a class, okay, but you don't want to extend that class and create a new class of that class, right? You can use extension functions. So what I can do is I can go ahead and create a function in the math class in Java that's called, let's say, quadruple, that takes in a number and returns the quadruple of it. So I don't need to extend the math class and create a new math class. I can simply use extension functions. I can directly create a method that I can call on any math class. Okay. So you'll see when you try to do the extension functions. Okay. There are higher order functions. So like it's like JavaScript but better. Okay. We have like map, flat map, all those operators available out of the box. Okay. And lastly, there's coroutines. So this is a new addition to Kotlin. Coroutines are like threads but on steroids. So like there was a talk this time at KotlinConf. So that guy, like the speaker, he spawned over 1 million threads and 1 million coroutines. So the threads that, like he spawned 1 million threads and that hung up his system. But the coroutines, they just like ran the entire operation in just 5 seconds. So like this is this uses thread pool to like perform all the operations. They only have 6 threads at a time. Okay, I'm getting too technical. But yeah, like this is a better variant of thread. You guys know about threads, right? Threads in Java. If you want to do multi-threaded programming, like we create a new thread, right? So that's that. Yeah, so like there are a lot of things in Kotlin. I believe like the next speaker is speaking on Kotlin Native, so I'm pretty sure he'll introduce a lot of these topics as well.
You have 5 minutes, man.
For sure. So like, okay, this was me when I was like doing Java, and this is me when I'm doing Kotlin, right? So yeah, feels good. Yeah. So lastly about my project. So this is Open Event Android. This is a FOSSASIA project. Okay. This project allows you to build an Android app for your event without writing a single line of Java code or Kotlin code. So yeah, you just go ahead, submit us a link of your event, and you click on the generate button, and you have it. You have the app for that event. You can upload it to Google Play Store. You can distribute it amongst your users. All you can do. And we recently shifted to Kotlin. Not entirely, but we are in the process of it. And some interesting statistics. Using Kotlin has led to a decrease in the number of lines of code. We have a less number of crashes, and we have reduced development and code review time by a huge margin, because naturally you write less code, you have to review less code. Makes sense. So yeah, so we have 7,000 less lines of code in our code base so far, and we are not even like done with the entire Kotlin conversion. We have 43% decrease in the number of reported crashes, mainly the null pointer exceptions. Okay, and we have 50% decrease in development time. Okay, at least that's for me, because I know Kotlin. Like, guys who don't know Kotlin, they are facing an increase in the review time because they have to go through the code and make sense of it. Okay, what's happening here? But for me, there's a 50% decrease. Okay. So yeah. So like, okay. So if you like what you just saw, the Kotlin thing and the Open Event Android thing, we need you guys. Okay, we need more developers who can help us out in making this app better. And yeah, if you like joining us, feel free to do that. We have the GitHub repo. I think I have that in my next slide. Okay, I don't. Anyways, so yeah, I'll be sure to like leave a link to it on this whiteboard. And yeah, so like feel free to join us, contribute. We have a lot of Kotlin conversion that's left. We have a lot of data classes or Java classes that are left. Like you can go ahead and start converting them into Kotlin. We have a lot of utility methods. You can start converting them into Kotlin. And yeah, like we'll be more than happy to have you guys on board. So this is me. You can find me on Twitter, and I often write some Medium articles on Kotlin. Recently jumped into Flutter, so I'm writing articles on Flutter as well. You can find me on Medium over here. And yeah, so any questions, guys? That's it from my side. Thank you. Any questions? Okay. I'll be around if you guys want.
I have a question. So I'm a JS developer, but it inspired me to learn Kotlin as well,
okay.
Right? So, will you suggest someone who does not know Java to directly start with Kotlin?
Why not? I mean, you just won't be able to appreciate the language, but yeah, you'll be able to work in it. Because like being a Java developer, I know the pain that Kotlin tries to solve. So I can relate to the things that are happening there. If you jump right into Kotlin, that's totally fine. You can do that. But you won't be able to like find the language like so fun or so interesting. Because like I know, okay, this thing breaks in Java, but this thing works in Kotlin. But you never tried Java,
yeah.
You won't be able to appreciate the language. But still, I am not suggesting that, okay, don't jump into Kotlin right away. But yeah, do jump into Kotlin. It's a fun language. It's a very good language.
Okay. For example, the iOS, Oblique to Shift, like it used to be like everybody is using the Oblique to Shift, and now everybody is shifting to the Swift.
Yep.
And the Swift is basically like updating 1, 2, 3, 4. and then based on that, they break the compatibility previous compatibility.
What's that happen, right? Yeah.
Do you think this Kotlin will be same or?
So Kotlin has been around since like this was first introduced in 2007. It's been 11 years and it's still working. So I've been using Kotlin since the past 8 years. 8 months. Sorry. 8 months, not years. So like I didn't face any like backward compatibility issues, right? Like if I'm on beta versions, definitely yes, things break. But on the stable release, stable channel, nothing breaks. Everything works flawless. As I mentioned, like Swift breaks because they're Apple. Okay. It's not open source. This is open source. Is it open source? Is Swift open source? Okay. But since they're Apple, right, so they break things. Kotlin. Yeah, so like nothing will break. Don't worry about it.
Any other questions?
Yeah. If I have an Android app written in Java, mm-hmm. Should I convert part by part into Kotlin, or I should start from scratch using Kotlin?
Convert it part by part. Like start, like, okay, don't start from scratch. Don't start from scratch because you can convert the existing code base from Java to Kotlin. You can do that. Okay. So like go ahead and find a simple Pojo class, like Java class that I just showed you. Board. Yeah. So this is Java class, right? You might be having many Java classes like this. Start by converting this into Kotlin. Because the syntax is very easy. Right, I'm not telling you to write idiomatic Kotlin. Like, don't write idiomatic Kotlin. Just start with very simple Kotlin. Start with this and just keep converting the code gradually. Right, don't like start anything from scratch. Okay.
If I'm using a lot of library, third-party library, mm-hmm. So do you face any issue like
none
written in Kotlin? Let's say you use like Java.
Any Java code will work with Kotlin. No issues over there. So any library, like even if it was written 6 years ago, it will work with Kotlin. Don't worry. Okay.
What's the minimum JDK version I can use Kotlin with?
Android?
I'm coming from Java web.
Okay, like I think, I'm not sure about the minimum version, but I think JDK 6, I tried it on devices running 6 and worked. So like, I'm not sure about the minimum version, sorry.
Because I'm working on, working mainly on maintaining web apps, can I use, if I were to work with Kotlin, can I mix in my application using Java classes and Kotlin classes?
Yeah, why not?
No problem.
You have my guarantee. You have my word on that.
okay, thank you so much.
Last question. Sir.
Okay, you have a question. Okay.
So I'm guessing, since the get and setter methods are kind of inferred, I can still overwrite my get and setter method.
You can do that.
Yes. Is there something like the override annotation?
It's a name type. You can do that. Like I don't have the code snippet right now, but we can chat after this talk. Like I can come back there and I can show you. Okay. You can definitely do that. Yes. You can also you can create getter setter over here. You can do that. You have the option to create a getter method over here.
Yeah, because I'm asking if the compiler, mm-hmm. is there some way for the compiler to enforce that I'm overwriting an existing property?
You can do that, yes. Okay. That's possible.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much
for being an awesome audience.
That was a great.